Great, and it's really great to be here this evening. Pleasure to have the chance to give you an overview of Redx. Some of you may be familiar with us. We've been a public company for a few years now. So let me obviously draw your attention to the disclaimers, as the other presenters have, and just give you a quick overview of the company. So we are all about innovative medicines. I joined the company. I'm the chief executive and have been for the last 3 years. Joined the company after extensive experience as a general manager, notably at AstraZeneca, and I've been involved in the sector for all of my career. And the reason I joined this company is because I really believe there's a fantastic science team here who had doing some really innovative work and have developed some great programs. And I'll tell you a little bit about that tonight. So we're AIM listed and we're focused on our pipeline now, driving it forward with quite a lot of value inflection points coming up over the next 12 to 18 months. And I'll take you through those. So what we do is we very much focus on validated oncology and fibrosis targets. We're all about taking those from preclinical work. So we discover those in-house through to clinical proof of concept, the end of phase two. And then we'll look at options for where we're best to take those forward, either through partnerships where we have a strong track record or ongoing development ourselves. Our real strength at the heart of the company is a very good medicinal chemistry and translational science team. We've got about an 80 strong team of people with experience from all different parts of the ecosystem in biotech and pharma. We're based up in Audley Park, just south of Manchester. And the team have a very good track record, including, as was just mentioned, a couple of major preclinical transactions we've done in the last couple of years with AstraZeneca and Jazz. I'll talk more about those in a second. So our business as it stands today is developed very rapidly over the last 2 or 3 years. We now have three real drivers of value in the company as we stand today. So firstly, we have our porcupine inhibitor program, which is an oncology program. It's a targeted therapy, and it's all about unlocking the potential of the Wnt pathway, which is a long-standing target pathway that drives cancer, drives tumors, and has most recently also been shown to drive the evasion of tumors in the immune system. So from two potentially exciting mechanisms of actions against cancer directly and also with the immune system, we believe we now have shown a mechanism that can target the Wnt ligand driven tumors. So those tumors that are driven by this Wnt ligand, I'll talk more about that. And the latest milestone we have is we just presented our phase one data at ESMO a few weeks ago, which was really good news and showed a number of the things that you want to see in phase one. We're delighted to have the tolerability profile, the target engagement profile to move into phase two. We've selected a dose. And so the big next step for us is to open up into phase two in those targeted tumors that are driven by this Wnt ligand. So that's the first program that we have in the company. I'll talk more about that. The second program we have in the company now, again, an in-house developed patented molecule, is a ROCK2 selective inhibitor. This one's called RXE007. This targets the ROCK pathway, which is really a master switch, if you like, in the pathway for fibrosis. It's a clinically validated target, and there's limited competition here because the chemistry is quite tricky to develop this ROCK2 selectivity. And we just released, in fact, last week, some very first initial results from our phase one, which is ongoing. And our goal here is to take that into phase two next year in idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. And I'll talk to you more about both of these two programs. But the third pillar of our company, and this is really, as I mentioned, the heart of our company, is this world-class medicinal chemistry team that we have. And I think it's important to mention that as a biotech, as an innovative medicines discovery company, we have a very strong track record. And I think I draw your attention to that because I think that's one of the things you look for when you look at a biotech company, is what have they actually delivered? And we have delivered five molecules that are either in the clinic or close to the clinic, the two that I'm going to talk about that we're developing in-house, but we also have three that we have partnered. And I think it's quite instructive to see the quality of the partners that we have, but also that those molecules are ongoing, which shows their real value in terms of potential applicability in the clinic is still being explored. So one is a BTK inhibitor that was licensed to Loxo Oncology, which was then subsequently bought by Eli Lilly. And that's the most advanced program. That's in about phase three. But we have two other partnership deals, which were late stage preclinical deals. One with Jazz for an oncology program that again is within 12 months of going in the clinic. And then finally, a fibrosis program, which we licensed to AstraZeneca last year, which again is going extremely well. We've had a milestone from that earlier this year, and we expect that to also go into the clinic. So all told, that gives us five molecules that this Redx team has invented in-house. And I think that track record for both the way we go about the science and the team is really pleasing. And so what we're investing in now is that team and targeting new targets in both oncology and fibrosis. And our goal here is to deliver another three INDs or another three molecules by 2025. So that gives you a sense of what our company is now focused on. Let me just turn to a little bit more detail in the next few moments on each of the two key programs. So starting with the porcupine inhibitor. Porcupine is this exciting target that I mentioned at the top of the Wnt pathway, which has long been established as a driver of cancer. It's quite challenging to drug, and that is one of the reasons we're particularly pleased to have developed a very potent orally active porcupine inhibitor, which is an enzyme sitting at the top of the Wnt pathway. And we think this is a very differentiated molecule now with encouraging clinical data. And one of the reasons we were so keen to target the Wnt pathway and specifically porcupine is because it covers all of the Wnt ligands, and that means there's less risk of redundancy in the pathway. If you target some of them, the tumor may find a workaround in terms of what's actually driving the cancer. So we think targeting all of the Wnt ligands, all 19 of them, is quite important. But the other reasons we really like this pathway is because it has this dual mechanism of action I mentioned at the beginning. So not only does Wnt drive cell proliferation, so the growth of tumors, but also the ability of a tumor to evade the immune system. So you will hear, and I believe you'll hear in the next presentation, a lot about turning cold tumors hot. That basically means making a tumor visible to the immune system and allowing the immune cells to come in and tackle the cancer. So this is one of the other mechanisms of action here with the Wnt pathway and with porcupine. And then the final reason that we really like this pathway is because we can be very clear about which patients to select, whose tumors are very much driven, if you like, addicted to the Wnt pathway. And their tumor growth is driven by the Wnt pathway. And we know that's because they either have genetic mutations, a couple of specific mutations listed on the slide here, RNF43 or an RSPO fusion that lead to this Wnt addiction, or they are tumors like a biliary cancer, which are heavily driven by Wnt ligand. So we are now in a position with this to move into phase two. And we're going to be looking at that in a couple of different settings, which I'll cover on the next slide. So Wnt covers tumors in quite a few different settings. So we have shaped a phase two program to really understand the potential of this drug and the efficacy of this drug now that we've shown it is tolerated in patients at the doses that we would want to see. So we're going to start with looking at a monotherapy in these genetically selected patients that I mentioned. And you can see on the right-hand side some of the numbers of the scale of this opportunity. So firstly, in colorectal cancer, you can see that MSS, which is actually the very hard to treat cancer where checkpoint inhibitors don't actually work, we're going to be looking about 8% of that colorectal cancer have these mutations. Also in pancreatic cancer, where about 5% of patients have these mutations. Now, these are very poorly prognostic diseases. As you can see, the five-year survivals are really poor, and that's because they're hard to treat settings. So this is a potential breakthrough for these types of patients. We're also going to look at monotherapy in these high Wnt ligand driven tumors. We're going to use biliary cancer as the example for that, where more than 70% of the patients in that setting will be driven by Wnt ligand. In the future, we may also have plans for other tumors where you see these genetic mutations. And importantly, one of the big opportunities is to combine with checkpoint inhibitors. So as I mentioned, the Wnt pathway, and when you target porcupine, you can potentially unveil the tumor to the immune system, and that can allow a checkpoint inhibitor to come in and tackle the tumor. And we think there's an extremely strong scientific rationale for this combination. We actually see Novartis going after this type of combination with their porcupine inhibitor. And we would like to look at that as well in colorectal cancer. So lots of potential opportunity, and our challenge has been to really design a phase two program that shows us this definitive proof of concept or efficacy signal. So it leaves us in a position now where we have a very highly potent, orally active, once daily inhibitor. We know that it's blocking the target in the right way, very, very selectively, looking at both tumor growth and immune evasion. We know from our phase one data that we have presented at ESMO earlier this year that we have manageable toxicity at the doses that we are wanting to go forward with. And we've also shown engagement of the target, which is really important. So we know we're hitting porcupine at these doses and where we've seen all of the preclinical efficacy. So that's what we know so far. What we're looking for now is to take forward the 2 milligram dose in this phase two program, which is now open, and we'll be starting to recruit that very shortly. We'll be looking at this prospectively now. We look retrospectively in our phase one data that we presented at ESMO, where we saw activity in these Wnt ligand driven tumors. We saw a difference between the activity of those patients that had Wnt ligand driven tumors and those that don't. So we'll now be testing that prospectively in the phase two moving forward. So we're very excited about the potential for showing efficacy prospectively in these patients. And we'll be commencing that monotherapy program in quarter four. And then importantly, we'll follow that up early next year with a combination program that will start in combination with PD-1s. So that's a quick walkthrough of the porcupine program. I'll turn now to our second program, which is our fibrosis program. This is called 007, and this is a selective ROCK2 inhibitor program. Again, the team of medicinal chemists back at Redx have designed an extremely attractive molecule, highly selective, orally active ROCK2 inhibitor with really good preclinical efficacy in quite a wide range of fibrotic disease models. We managed to get this, this is quite a difficult chemistry, as I've mentioned, but we managed to get this into phase one earlier this year. And the reason we're very, very keen on this program and have chosen to take this forward in-house at Redx is that ROCK2 is this master switch, if you like. It's a ROCK is a nodal point in the cell signaling pathway for fibrosis. And typically, or historically, this has been quite challenging because if you hit ROCK as a target, and you can see where it sits in the pathway on the left-hand side of this slide, there's two forms of ROCK. There's one and two. And if you hit both of them, you can get hypertension. So this drop in blood pressure in the patients, which is not good for a systemic drug. So we've had to design selectively to hit ROCK2 and not to hit ROCK1. That's the bit of chemistry that's proved quite challenging. So there are relatively few selective ROCK2 inhibitors. We have managed to do that. We do see it as a validated target now. There is a compound that has been approved in the States for chronic graft versus host disease and actually now has been acquired by Sanofi because the company that developed that has been acquired by Sanofi. So we see this as a very exciting opportunity to take forward, and we're going to build this program out in idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, which, as you can see on this slide, is a really high unmet need. Actually, the prognosis for this fibrotic disease is very poor, as poor as lung cancer, often in terms of mortality for these patients. There are a couple of approved treatments for IPF that slow the disease down, but they have some limited utility because they have side effects, and there's a very clear opportunity to improve on the standard of care here, which is what we would like to do with this kind of master switch of fibrosis, to turn that process off. And we know ROCK2 is heavily involved in IPF, and building on the preclinical efficacy, we think this is a very exciting opportunity to take forward and show efficacy in a phase two. So where are we now? We know we have, as I've mentioned, this highly potent and selective orally active ROCK2 inhibitor that we're very excited about. We've shown the preclinical efficacy that we would want to see, and that supports our clinical development plan. We've shown and just released some initial data from phase one that's ongoing, where we've got a really good safety profile. We haven't seen any adverse events in that phase one study to date. And we've seen the pharmacokinetic profile in the healthy volunteers in phase one that is what we would like to see. So we're continuing that. We're going to continue to escalate the doses. These are single doses, and we'll look for multiple doses. And then in the first half of next year, we're intending to start our phase two in the IPF setting. And initially, we'll do that as a 12-week study to look at efficacy and safety, tolerability in IPF patients, to really understand the engagement with the target, the dose levels, and the role in disease. Once we've done that dose ranging study, we'll then do a definitive efficacy study in phase 2b. So that's our plan for the ROCK2. And then just before I stop and turn to questions, perhaps a few words on our financing. Some of you that may have followed the company will know that we've had a very strong investment over the last 18 months. We now have, at the end of March, the latest reported figure we have is 40 million of cash in the bank, which takes us through to the end of next year. We also have supplemented milestones. We've received milestones, as I mentioned, from AstraZeneca earlier this year, but also Jazz. So ongoing milestones from our programs. If you add all those milestones up over the lifetime of those partnered programs, that's potentially $1 billion in revenue if all of the milestones are hit, and they are both ongoing at this point in time. So our investors came in. We're majority owned by Redmile Group, US specialist group. We also brought in more specialist investors, Sofinnova Partners and Polar Capital, which really underlines our commitment to taking forward programs now into the clinic. So going beyond being a preclinical company to very much being a clinical company with two programs about to go into phase two. So I think I'll leave it there. You can see the key milestones we've got coming up now for both the porcupine inhibitor programs, lots happening with the phase two program started, and our combination phase one completing, results reading out during next year, and then also the ROCK2 program completing our phase one and moving into phase two, and then this exciting target of three new INDs by 2025. So that's where we're focused as Redx. So let me turn over to some questions.
I knew you would put that experienced in-house scientific team right at the end, because that is how you started. And you really impressed upon us how experienced this in-house scientific team is, what they have achieved, five molecules. You're wearing it like a big badge of honor. However, what happens, Lisa, if one of that team goes?
Yeah, so I mean, I think that's always the risk in any business. You know, we are a small group who are very committed to what we're trying to do. I think we have a very strong approach. So our ways of working in medicinal chemistry, obviously our chief scientific officer is Richard Armour, has been with the company quite a number of years. And underneath him, there's a very experienced team of chemists. So, you know, I'm a big believer in building a team. I'm a big believer in people taking opportunities. I took this opportunity to move to Redx because I felt we could really do something with this science and this team from AstraZeneca. So everyone develops their careers and people will move on for good reasons. So at some point that may well happen, but my firm belief is that we now have a critical mass. We have sufficient people who understand how we go about drug discovery, this kind of Redx approach to drug discovery. And I think it's really powerful. Clearly, in this market, no one knows what will happen in the future. But I think if there's any team who's going to crack some of these chemistry challenges, I would back the team that we have in-house at Redx.
And I tell you what, there's more people than I are pleased that you took the risk to become chief executive of the company. Tim Grattan says you seem to have extraordinary success with your discovery programs. What's the secret? Are you using some unique computational chemistry or artificial intelligence, or do you just employ exceptional people in that area?
Well, a good question, Tim, and I think a lot of biotechs that I've come across in my experience do tend to have a sort of black box element about what they do and their sort of proprietary technology. And, you know, I think the simplest way I'll quote Richard, our chief scientific officer here, because I think it's a good phrase, is, you know, this is not artificial intelligence. This is good old fashioned human intelligence. You know, we are about, that's not to say, let me be very clear, that we don't use a lot of the latest technologies and computational chemistry, as you would expect. But I think there's a real experience in the team about how to go about drug discovery, what to look for, what properties to anticipate to actually make a drug successful, not just to kind of in the preclinical models, but to actually have the legs to be either once or day, to have the right druggable properties when you get into the clinic. And that's why I'm very proud of the five drugs, though I should be clear, three of them are in the clinic and two are close to being in the clinic. But I think it's understanding what those properties are and really building that into your programs. So they're a very tight-knit, cross-functional team with a lot of experience. And I think that pays dividends. The other thing I would say in our probability of success is we don't go after blue sky biology targets. So we go after targets that have some sort of validation. And that plays a big factor in our success rates, because we're not doing the very high risk biology. We're looking at targets like porcupine in the target where Novartis has done some work there. The biology of the Wnt pathway has long been driving cancer. Now, it has been difficult to drug, but in porcupine, we think we have a target that now has some validation. So I think it's both the people factor and picking the right targets where we think we can improve on something and make a real difference, and that we can also apply our team to design a molecule that can deliver on a target product profile.
It is an international team. I understand that your chief financial officer is domiciled in the USA, which makes sense because, you know, you've got the backing of Red Mile Group in the US. So therefore, would it make sense to have a dual listing and perhaps a NASDAQ quote?
Yeah, so obviously, I'm not going to, you know, we are AIM listed, and obviously, as a, you know, company, we have tried to build our investor base, and particularly to build our investor base with specialist investors, of which you mentioned Redmile, and I also touched on Sofinnova and Polar, and we're really pleased to have them come in. So I think for me, the really important thing is to make sure the company is well financed and well supported to deliver on the programs that we have so that we can build the value in Redx. That's not to say we won't do partnering. I think we've shown we can and will do partnering when it makes sense for us to do that, but that we want to have the financial muscle to be able to drive the programs that I've talked about. So we've deliberately put our chief financial officer in the US, as you just pointed out. Pete Collum joined us in May, so that we could build our relationship with US investors, because there are a lot of specialist investors in the US. And I think as a global biotech company, you want to make sure you have access to the best capital. I think that's a very separate question from where are you listed. However, obviously, the board will look at all options, but the real driver is, have we got access to capital that's going to understand the risk and have the specialist due diligence to really invest in these programs? And I think as retail investors, it should be very reassuring to see the specialist investors come in. And I think that's something I would certainly be looking for in a company, because you know that they've really looked at these programs in an awful lot of depth.
Okay, let's have a look at the programs then. And Andrew Nesbitt asks, how does the ROCK2 inhibitor compare with the LOXL2 inhibitors in terms of their fibrosis activity?
Yeah, so I think the fibrosis area is not as well understood in all of the pathways as cancer. But I think, so let me just say that up front, because we sometimes have a lot more granularity. There are quite, therefore, a number of different mechanisms playing out in fibrosis. And I think that's something that we see. There are very few ROCK2 inhibitors. There are lots of mechanisms who are trying to play at fibrosis. So LOXL2 is, you know, there are lots of mechanisms. I'm not an expert in those mechanisms. Some of them are good. That one, I think, is one of the good ones. Some of them have proved not to be so good. So if I look at idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, one of the areas that we've chosen to go into where there's high unmet need, it is a very fibrotic disease. And there's quite a number of players have tried to test their mechanism of action in that area. There have been a number of failures, right? And so they can fail either because of safety. So the drugs are not actually safe enough. We're very fortunate with ROCK2 that we've got a very safe profile. And we know that from what we've seen, but we also know that from Cadman, who have a ROCK2 selective inhibitor that has been FDA approved. And I think that's important. And secondly, you want to look for the efficacy. And in fibrosis, it seems that if you have a nodal point in the pathway, i.e. you have a kind of multiple pathways are triggered off it, that's what you need, because it's quite tough to tackle. So one of the things that's attracted us to ROCK2 is that it is this nodal point in the fibrotic pathway. So we tend to call it the sort of master switch for the pathway of fibrosis. And it therefore is related to many of the other mechanisms that are being tested for fibrotic action. So I think it's to be played out which are the best approaches. We're very committed to ROCK because of its safety profile, its nodal approach, and it makes a lot of sense. It has some validation. That's not to say that other mechanisms of actions will also potentially have some role in fibrosis, and potentially different organs for fibrosis may be suited to slightly different approaches. For example, in NASH, which we were also looking at, we think it might be a combination approach that we will need to look at.
Supplementary question about ROCK2 from Tim Grattan. He says, is the selective ROCK2 inhibitor a small non-peptide molecule, and does it have satisfactory oral bioavailability?
Yes. To give you the short answer. So we are a small molecule company, right? So all of our expertise is in small molecules. And yes, it's orally available. We have shown in the phase one data that we just released last week, and this is interim data, but we've escalated up from 2 milligrams up to 40 milligrams, single ascending dose. And you can see good availability. And we think that at the 40 milligrams, there's actually a half-life that would give us a once daily dose.
And John Williamson asks, what toxicity have you seen in phase one with the WNT inhibitor?
Yeah, so the WNT pathway is a very central pathway. So I think it's one of the reasons that I've mentioned a couple of times it's quite challenging to drug, is because it is a central pathway, and therefore you do get some toxicities, which is very common, obviously, with most oncology treatments. So what we've seen, and we've presented that in the full slide, I don't have in this deck, but it is on our website, of the toxicities that we presented. I think you can see, typically, historically, the one that you see with WNT is bone toxicity. We haven't seen that in our phase one trial, partly due to dose and partly due to the fact that we used prophylactic denosumab, which is, a bone protectant. And that manages to protect your bone mineral density from the action of a WNT inhibitor, which is a very good strategy anyway for oncology patients who've had chemotherapy and their bone is challenged. So that actually we were pleased to see was well managed. We did see some GI disturbances. We did see some loss of taste. So the rapid turnover of cells in the taste buds, that's probably the only one that was dose related that we saw. And then at the dose limiting, when we got to 3 milligrams, the dose limiting toxicity was actually colitis.
Let's end on some sexy numbers. You briefly touched on the milestone payment of $3 million from Jazz Pharmaceuticals as recently as last month. I'm just wondering how much more there is to come, because I know you're entitled to up to $203 million US dollars in development, regulatory, commercial milestone payments, and maybe even royalties too. Wouldn't that be nice if you had that $203 million US dollars?
Yeah, so, I mean, just to be clear, one of the figures I gave my earlier slide is if you add up all of our deal, our partnerships, so with AstraZeneca and the PanRef deal that we, the preclinical deal with Jazz, plus the research collaboration that we have with Jazz, which is on two targets, all told, that was $1 billion of milestones. So the 200 million is the PanRAF, but there is also, now obviously that would require all of those milestones to be hit, you know, so we often talk in our industry about bio dollars, as you know, because there is risk with those programs still, but I think it's very important to underline that we do have a financial interest in these programs. Both of them are ongoing. We have received good milestones, single-digit million-dollar milestones from both programs this year. We would expect to see more milestones when they go into the clinic, both of which will have the opportunity to do so in the next 12 months. So it is a significant revenue stream for us.
What a lovely way to end. I love those big, round, juicy numbers. And I've never heard that expression before, bio dollars. I always learn things from you, Lisa. Thank you very much. Lisa Anson, Chief Executive of Redx Pharma. Thank you very much indeed for joining us. Lovely to see you. Thank you.